Hi, I'm Buriana, you're watching Art Unplugged. Screaming popes, contorted bodies trapped in cages, torturous couplings and butchered flesh. This is the world of Francis Bacon, a troubled soul and a painter of no formal training who eventually became one of the greatest artists of the 20th century. Be it from his own tumultuous life or simply an uncanny ability to tap into the darkest corners of our consciousness, Bacon always makes us feel something. Like good horror movies, his paintings are at once disturbing and magnetic, repelling and irresistible. He lived in the epicenter of London's bohemian scene, leading a hedonistic life of excessive drinking and gambling. His turbulent love life was a string of passionate, painful, and tragic relationships. A bitter loner who craved for love all his life, but couldn't deal with it when he found it, Bacon blended historical, autobiographical, and literary elements to capture the terrors and temptations of the 20th century with honesty and raw emotion. Francis Bacon was born in Dublin in 1901 to an English family with no Irish ties. His father was a retired army officer turned horse breeder, and his mother was a self-absorbed socialite. Bacon was an effeminate, sickly child suffering from chronic asthma, averse to manly outdoor pursuits, a disappointment to his belligerent and argumentative father. Growing up, Bacon had a difficult and ambivalent relationship with his parents, especially his father, who struggled with his son's emerging homosexuality, and by his own account, he was expelled from the household in 1926 after Major Bacon caught his son trying on his mother's underwear. The 16-year-old Bacon went to London with no clear idea of what he wanted to do. He simply drifted, kept afloat by a modest allowance from his mother, a series of odd jobs and casual encounters with older men. In a final attempt to influence his son's life, Bacon's father arranged for Francis to accompany a relation on his wife's side, an ultra-masculine character, on a trip to Berlin, hoping that this would cure his son's effeminacy. Instead, the macho guardian turned out to be a sexual predator who took advantage of the teenage boy. Berlin of the roaring 20s was an overwhelming cultural experience for the young Bacon. He savored both its opulence and its squalor. The erotic life of the city was startlingly uninhibited, and the artistic scene was thriving. Abandoned by his lover, Bacon drifted to France, where he studied French, visited exhibitions by Picabia, de Chirico and Soutin, and viewed the latest releases at the cinema. In the summer of 1927, he saw an exhibition of drawings by Picasso, which struck a deep chord with him. Bacon decided to become an artist and began making drawings and watercolors, apparently without formal guidance. Eventually, he settled in London in 1928 and worked for a few years as an interior decorator. Despite of his recollections of being painfully shy, Bacon had the knack of meeting people who could help him develop his talents. Starting with absolutely no technical training, he gradually entered the world of art and quickly assimilated what other artists near him, such as Roy de Meester, were able to teach him from the technical standpoint. Most of his paintings from this time have been lost. Bacon regularly destroyed works he didn't like, particularly so during his early years. But the few that survive clearly show the early influence of the Surrealists and Picasso's biomorphic cubism, which would lead Bacon to develop a language of his own. Bacon's recognition came in April 1945, when his three studies for figures at the base of a crucifixion 1944 won him almost instant notoriety. The triptych with its hot orange background and stone-colored monsters of vaguely human descent left a lasting and disquieting impression with the public and the critics. According to Bacon, the figures were inspired by the Furies, the deities of vengeance from Aeschylus's trilogy Orestia. The work was seen immediately as a brutally frank and pessimistic response to the Second World War. Its unveiling coincided with the month when the concentration camps were revealed to the world, so it was inevitably understood as a statement on human brutality and suffering. In the 50s, Bacon got obsessed with Diego Velázquez's famous portrait of Pope Innocent X, which he knew only from reproductions. He painted more than 30 works known as the Screaming Popes, in which the image of the pontiff is converted into a nightmarish icon of hysterical terror. In some of them, it mingles with the face of the injured woman who appears screaming in Eisenstein's film Battleship Potemkin, which Bacon had discovered in Berlin as a young man and which left a deep impression on him. In 1953, the artist painted two nude men together for the first time, an image which could not be shown publicly in England, where homosexuality was still a crime. This is one of Bacon's most acclaimed but little seen paintings. It was created at the cottage of his violent lover Peter Lacy, where, according to biographer John Richardson, the artist spent a lot of time in bondage. Bacon's classic mix of sex, death, and animal instincts explodes directly through the buzzing vertical lines, the corpse blue flesh, and the grin of pleasure and pain on the figures' faces. In the 60s, Bacon returned to the format of the triptych, revisiting the crucifixion theme with the Three Studies for a Crucifixion, 1962, a work that marks the beginning of his mature period. In the Middle Ages, triptychs were hinged together so they could fold in and out to tell a religious story. Bacon was fascinated by the Christian nature of the triptych, yet his own triptychs paint a violent vision of a godless universe. Unlike typical triptychs, which usually display three stages of a narrative, Bacon used this format to present three separate scenes, seeking an emotional connection between them rather than a sequence in space or time. Seen this way, the imagery of Three Studies for a Crucifixion, 1962, remains open to interpretation, though its emotional impact is unmistakable. Bacon's works from his mature period are more autobiographical, focused on the human figure, the relationship between two people, both physical and psychological, was a theme that always preoccupied the artist. Although Bacon was sometimes reluctant to specifically identify the subjects of his paintings, a number of them were inspired by his fraught, often violent and passionate relationships, like Peter Lacy, a former fighter pilot whom he met in 1952. Even after Lacy died in 1962, Bacon continued to paint portraits of him, recalling intensely intimate moments in their relationship. In 1963, Bacon met George Dyer, a petty criminal from London's East End. Dyer succeeded Lacy as Bacon's lover and model, and was the inspiration for many of Bacon's grandest and most emotive paintings of the male nude. Dyer committed suicide two nights before the opening of Bacon's retrospective at the Grand Palais in Paris, an exceptional honor for a living painter. A series of paintings made over the next few years record the true strength of his grief. Faces and bodies mingled in torturous homoerotic vortexes, or isolated figures in everyday poses, the painter transformed them until they were virtually unrecognizable, twisting them in an almost animal-like way. Bacon's bodies look like carnal sculptures that reveal all their angles in a single glance. In Bacon's paintings, the human presence is evoked sometimes viscerally, at others more fleetingly in the form of a shadow or a blurred watchful figure. In certain instances, male and female bodily traits are transposed or fused. Often, Bacon's twisted figures are placed in what looks like a stage or a circus arena, creating in the viewer the unsettling feeling of witnessing a sinister spectacle of torture or sexual violence. Sometimes the subjects of his paintings appear trapped in linear cages, one of Bacon's signature graphic devices. They're displayed, served up, exposed and confined in this traumatizingly lonely space that is human existence. Yet, his paintings are perversely beautiful. Bacon's brush creates horrific wounds and knotted masses of flesh with a disturbingly gorgeous painterly texture. His paintings shine with opulent color and captivate with frightful magnificence. The pain and brutality that echoes through them amplifies their strange beauty. In the wake of the Second World War, when art took the escapist route of abstract expressionism with its withdrawal from reality, or looked for solace in the gleeful garishness of pop art, Francis Bacon was the bitter loner, the queer misfit who chose the hard way to catharsis, facing his personal demons and the demons of the collective consciousness with ruthless honesty. And though his images seem despairing, disturbing and painful, we keep returning and we keep looking at them, savoring the sweet pain of our own healing.
I don't know why they always think that I take horrifying subjects. I don't think there's anything horrifying about my subjects, because the more violently, more strongly you feel about life, the more strongly you must be aware of death.
I hope you enjoyed this video. What do you think of Francis Bacon? I'm really interested to hear your thoughts, especially if it is your first encounter with him. So leave me a comment. Please like, share and subscribe, hitting the bell so that you get notifications about my future videos. If you want to see my work as an artist, please find me on social media. All the links are in the description below. Thanks for watching, and I will see you soon. Bye.